Good morning. If grief could be explained in a picture, it would be this: the ever-growing pile of flowers left outside Westfield Bondi Junction in memory of the six people murdered there on Saturday. Mourners are the only people arriving at what is one of Australia's biggest shopping precincts, which until very early this morning was still a crime scene. And flags around the country now fly at half-mast. It's a way for the nation to show its support and its sympathy. Well, Masili Ali joins us live from outside Westfield Bondi Junction. Mas, good morning to you. The last victim has now been identified.
That's right, Davina. Yixuan Cheng is the last victim that's been identified among the six people that were killed here on Saturday. Now, she is a Chinese international student here in Sydney studying economics at the University of Sydney. Now, she was inside the centre, inside the Chanel store on Saturday, shopping, trying things on and sending videos to her friends in the moments before 40-year-old Joel Cauchy launched a brutal attack, stabbing her and killing her. Now, her story has already touched so many people here today, among them a couple who were also international students from China who came all the way here from Western Sydney to lay flowers and pay their respects to Yixuan. We spoke to them. Take a listen.
She's one of our international students. Like, we were used to be international students as well. We can understand how, you know, how shocked her family will be and how sad, like everyone would be.
This is the saddest time I've been here. So it's like, we don't want to see these things happen in the future.
We're still also hearing those incredible stories of survival here this morning. Among them, Bill Mahana. His partner, Victoria, is the owner of Hair Royale, a salon on the fifth floor. And they were among the people who were forced into lockdown with other shoppers on Saturday. He's described to us the sheer terror they experienced as they waited in the back room of that salon with a mum and her young son waiting for the all clear from police to be able to evacuate. Take a listen.
We all go in the back room and I'm like, just don't use your phones, don't use nothing, just hide, hide. And everyone, so they put the little kid in the corner, the mum lays over the child to protect him. And I'm trying to keep cool myself. Like, I'm trying to, like, you know, hold it myself, but I'm shaken. I'm terrified myself of what I've just seen.
Now, as you can see behind me, the tributes have doubled in the last 12 hours and they are still growing. People have been constantly trickling in here this morning, laying flowers and paying their respects. Among them was former Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull. We spoke to him briefly. Now, of course, he represented this community for many years and he told us just how proud he is of his community for being able to come together in such a time of tragedy. As for the crime scene, police is still inside the centre this morning, but they tell us they are now in the process of transferring it back to centre management. Once that happens, management will be in touch with all of the shop owners, all of the businesses, and they can begin that process of reopening. But for now, we've been told that it is still a few days away. Davina.
Miss Celia, thank you. Well, 18 people were stabbed in the Bondi attack, but the number of people who've been affected stretches much further. Damien Ryan joins us. Damo, we've actually heard from two stars of Sydney Breakfast Radio this morning. They have a personal link to this.
Well, there were thousands in the store on Saturday, and there are many, many people caught up in this. And as you rightfully said, we've heard some pretty startling and tragic information today. We've heard heartbreaking stories, and they're coming to light as we move on from this tragedy. And we're hearing just how loved ones of the victims learnt the news. Mm. And we do know that one of those victims was 25-year-old Dawn Singleton, of course, the daughter of businessman John Singleton. And on radio this morning, broadcaster Ray Hadley is good mates with John Singleton. He revealed the news, how he had to pass on that information, that tragic information to Singo, that his daughter had passed away.
And then I got a text from Singo about 6:30 pleading for me to ring him. Didn't know what it was about. We've been mates for 30 years. I rang him and he said, I think my Dawnie is one of those who's lost their life. And I can't confirm it. Can you do something? So I said, I'll do what I can. I rang some contacts in police, and I rang the police commissioner and asked her if she had any names, and she said only one, and confirmed it was Dawn, a beautiful 25-year-old girl. So I've known her since she was born, and I had the job of ringing John back and officially confirming that his dear, darling daughter had been stabbed to death by this lunatic.
So, tragic. There's also another thing worth pointing out there. You see those images of Dawn and her boyfriend down on his knees.
So happy.
Now, they were due to get married, and she just picked up her wedding dress. Mm-hmm. And also, he's a police officer, and he was responding to the scene of Bondi, not knowing that his partner had been murdered. Then we have another story today about Kyle Sanderlin's confirmed on his radio station that his wife Tegan's aunt was wounded in the attack. So there are just so many connections here. And so Kyle Sanderlin's then confirmed his insight into how this all played out on Saturday. So these are just two stories. There'd be countless more after what happened on Saturday.
We need to hold on to the stories of hope, don't we?
Sure.
Damo, thank you. Well, right now there are 8 people still being treated for stab wounds in hospitals across Sydney. Madison Scott is outside St Vincent's for us. Maddie, good morning to you. Can you give us an update on the condition of those patients?
Davina, thankfully, 4 patients who were still fighting for life yesterday have now stabilised even further overnight. 2 of those are here at St Vincent's Hospital in ICU, 1 at RPA, and of course, 1 being that little 9-month-old baby who received vital surgery on Saturday night. They were all in a critical condition yesterday and have now transitioned into a serious but stable condition. So some slightly good news there. Now, as you said, 8 people are still being cared for in hospital. We do know that 4 of the victims were discharged within the past 24 hours, and no doubt the nation's thoughts and prayers are behind everyone involved for a speedy recovery. Davina.
That we are, Maddie. Okay, thank you. Well, a man has died in a multi-vehicle crash just north of Sydney. It happened before 5 a.m. around 2 kilometres north of the Wurundjeri exit. Northbound lanes have just reopened after being closed all through this morning's commute. Earlier northbound traffic was backed up more than 10 km on the first weekend of school holidays. Pro-Palestine activists are unleashing chaos across Melbourne this morning as part of protest action in cities around the world. Gillian Lantouris joins us live from Melbourne. Jill, traffic was brought to a standstill.
It was, Davina. As you can see, it's pretty calm now, but this all kicked off around 7 o'clock this morning. Pro-Palestinian protesters gathered here at Parliament steps. Their aim was to cause mass disruption across the city. Throughout the morning, we saw various snap rallies pop up and surprise motorists all across the city. In Lorimer Street, we had protesters actually chain themselves and glue themselves onto the road before 12 people were arrested in that incident. Of course, that's the area where the ports are, so they were trying to blockade all those workers from going into work there. Then on Hoddle Street, on the end of the M3, another major arterial in Melbourne, the protesters went onto the street. It got quite hairy. There were motorists actually trying to push those protesters down before they left without any incident with police. But as you can hear in the background, a lot of frustrated motorists this morning. Now, here at Parliament Steps, the protesters marched throughout the CBD, closing all the streets here. There were trams that backed up for kilometres down here. And then another 2 protesters have actually been arrested and charged with criminal damage. They're accused of tampering with the traffic lights. They were on flash for quite some time. So quite frustrating for motorists here, but we did catch up with one of the organisers a bit earlier to explain what their goal was. Take a listen.
We have the right for peaceful assembly, we have the right to protest, and we intend to use these rights today. By disruption, we need a peaceful demonstration at multiple choke points across this country. Our objective is to make the government listen to the cries of the people.
Activists say this is just a taste of what's to come. There's rallies planned in the future in the coming days and weeks, but including tonight at 6 o'clock in the northern suburb of Broadmeadows. Davina.
Okay, Jill, thank you.